package cuts, then taxes, property, sales, and income will have to go higher. Here's why. Our school districts face an upcoming deficit of $7.6 billion by 2015, with compensation package costs swallowing 96% of all revenue, at least 4% for everything else. Two of the five government pension funds are functionally bankrupt, and the other three face unfunded liabilities totaling tens of billions of dollars. In the last 11 years, Ohio's private sector has bled over 500,000 net jobs, as government lost a mere 15,000 jobs. The likeliest recovery for Ohio's private sector is sometime in the early 2020s, when today's fourth graders will be seniors in high school. If you take away one thing from my remarks, let it be this. We have 500,000 fewer private sector workers today to fund roughly the same number of government workers as 11 years ago, whose compensation packages have exploded. A former state legislator saw her salary quadruple to $320,000. A state nurse averaged $200,000 3 years in a row due to yearly overtime of $130,000 plus, rendering his pension north of $140,000 a year. The city of Dayton spent $500,000 for workers to get their birthday off. The city of Cincinnati had 10 employees eligible for $200,000 or more in unused leave. Taxpayers in the city of Toledo paid both the employer's share of the worker's pension and the employee's share of their pension, totaling roughly a third of what each worker makes. Even though state workers had alleged pay freezes over the last few years, 54% received a raise in 2010. In school districts all over Ohio, elementary and middle school teachers are making over $90,000 for working 1,350 contractual days, which equates to nearly $150,000 salary for a 2080 work year, which is what most people in the private sector work. Upper-level police and fire personnel are receiving lump sum payments in excess of $1 million when they retire. This spring, taxpayers got stuck paying for teachers to take time off to attend labor union rallies under the label of professional leave, and we also got stuck for the cost of substitutes. We are living a fiscally unsustainable existence. Something must give. Higher taxes or lower government costs. What will you choose? Do you have the courage of your convictions? Those seeking higher taxes most certainly do. As one governor noted, Rosa Parks was simply just a simple seamstress who had worked a long day and was on her bus ride home. The bus became crowded and the driver wanted her seat for a white passenger was standing. When told to move, Rosa Parks, who had suffered a lifetime of indignities and was just tired of giving in, mustered the courage to say no more. On a beautiful September morning, men and women began their day aboard an airplane headed to or from business trips and vacations. In the course of that flight, men inspired by a warped version of Islam hijacked the plane with the intent to crash it into the Capitol or White House. Upon hearing about the other planes, the passengers aboard Flight 93 accepted their fate and showed the steely courage necessary to force that plane into the ground, thereby saving more innocent lives. Over the next 18 months, you will face steep challenges that will test you like you've never been tested before. Will you muster the courage in the moment, like Rosa Parks and like those passengers on Flight 93, needing to overcome the challenges ahead? Will you have the courage to educate others, to speak out when doing so will make you unpopular with neighbors, friends, even family members? Will you have the courage to loudly proclaim enough? As George Romney famously said, if not us, then who? If not now, then when? Our state and nation must be pulled back from the edge of apathy and dependence. We must renew and revigorate Winthrop's vision. We can win this battle and make our state great again, but courageous action is required. When the dust settles, how will you answer this simple question? Did you do everything you could possibly do? I implore you not to leave yourself answering no. Thank you very much. Happy to take questions on any subject you'd like to talk about.
High school classes and college classes?
I took that speech to Oberlin in the heart of liberalism because they invited me, the Libertarian Republican group there invited me, but have not had a chance to get into many high schools or other colleges at this point with that speech.
That would be a great speech in all high schools.
Great.
And a college.
Right. Yeah. We'll see about doing that. I think you're right. I appreciate those kind words. Yeah, we're going to get it on video.
Sir, some of these statistics that you pointed out was kind of a long litany of various statistics.
Yeah.
Are those statistics available on your website?
They are. All of those statistics essentially come out of the various reports that we write. So they all cite back to the Bureau of Labor Studies, the Census Bureau, the state data. So yeah, all that information really just comes out of the work we do every day at the Buckeye Institute.
Well, I understand that, but there's so many statistics.
Oh yeah.
And it's hard to sit here and take notes and get that all on paper. Is there a place I can go that will set that down, bam, 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 one after another, like you read?
Oh yeah, I can actually just send the group the PDF of the speech. Sure, you bet.
Would be good.
That would be, if you get that out to people, what these people make, these school teachers and everything else, and then the state issue slide, if people actually knew what was going on and how much these people were actually being paid, maybe there wouldn't be such pushback on state issue slide.
I think the reality is we're going to probably the next week publish what we call an egregious examples list. It'll be on the website that kind of runs through some of those examples and others that highlight some of these issues with compensation packages. And then additionally, who's been on the website, our website? If you haven't, you really should go. On the left-hand side are these salary tools that essentially allow you to search the salaries of every federal worker in Ohio, every postal worker in Ohio, every state worker in Ohio, every K-12 school employee in Ohio public, all the higher ed schools in Ohio, public higher ed, and many local governments. And so you can see what their salaries have been over the last several years, and then also it tells you what their estimated pension will be once they retire with the formulas that they use. We've had that on there for now, 15 months, almost 600,000 visitors from 533 Ohio cities have done, kid you not, 3.4 million searches of the data. So people are getting smart on this, but we got to get that out there far more because education is what creates the movement we need.
What is your website?
Yeah. It's on the back of that brochure you've got.
Oh, I'm sorry.
And in the next week and a half, we're going to start this program where we're actually going to hit a bunch of suburban newspapers where we're going to put a one-page ad about getting the facts that will highlight these issues, and we're going to create a single page on the website that has everything you could possibly want on collective bargaining reform that we've done. It'll have the salary tools. We actually also did this thing we call it compare your job. You can go onto the website, and if you're a nurse or you're a lawyer or you're a groundskeeper, you can compare what you make, as you know, to what the state workers are making. We give you the low state worker, the high state worker, and the median for that for each job. There's about 2,000 jobs on there to compare yourself to. We have all the charts and reports that we've published, so lots of that. We have a couple documents out, the top 10 myths of collective bargaining reform, 5 more myths of collective bargaining reform. There are 2 videos on there. One is the 15 myths of collective bargaining reform that go through the 15. The other one is, has anybody seen those videos with the cats talking to each other? You know, have you seen those at all? But you should go to this website. So I did one of those, because you just go on there and you can put in the dialogue. And we call it the Brotherhood of Brothers Union. And the unions hate it because it makes fun of the whole concept of brotherhood.
I think when they come up with some kind of mass mailing on that, like a brochure, because a lot of people don't use computers.
Yeah, well,
use a computer.
We're actually in the process of producing what will be a little flip thing that has about 10 pages on it with basically easy to understand charts that show lots of great little things for people to know. One shows, here's what this median state worker makes, and here's what the private sector person makes, and here's what the gap will be over the next 30 years as things continue. And that's just pay, doesn't include benefits. When you add those numbers I gave you about 87 out of 88 counties, 85 out of 88 counties, and 69 out of 88 counties, that's just pay. That doesn't even include the sick leave benefit. Government workers make about 4 to 5 times greater sick leave benefits than private sector workers. Healthcare average in Ohio for private sector is 23%. State workers pay 17%. Most local government workers are paying 8 or 9%. The pension, you can't even talk about the pension because it's so generous. It's just unbelievable. And in many local areas, your wonderful elected officials who represent you at the bargaining table have actually agreed not only to pay your 14% for teachers and local government workers, 19% for police officers, and 24.5% for firefighters, but have agreed to pick up the share that they're supposed to pay to their own retirement, which means you pay anywhere between 24% and 34.5% for each government worker of their salary into the pension every year. And then for some of the superintendents of your school districts, they get even better deals. We call it the pickup of the pickup, which is you pay your share, our share, taxpayer share of their pension, we pick up their share of the pension, and we allow the superintendent to include our share of their pension into their base salary that then goes into the highest three-year average for their pension. So they bump it up another 20, 30,000 in order to make sure that their retirement is up about another 10 grand over the course of time. So it's that kind of nefarious stuff that is just pervasive all across Ohio right now.
This will be in the upcoming newspaper pages, or
The newspaper piece will actually drive people to that one page that they can get all this stuff and the easy to see charts, and you'll love it. It's going to be a really neat. And we have already seen it. We're getting it designed. The ad needs to be very simple to draw to in order for people to look at it, and then hopefully they go to the get the facts part of the website to really educate themselves and get down in the trenches and show the courage that we need to show to be back over the next 18 months, the assault that's going to come against us. The unions are going to spend about $20-25 million over the next 4 months.
Is that just on Senate Bill 5?
Just on Senate Bill 5. Richard Trumka, the head of FL-CIO, was in town 2 days ago, because that's when the state Secretary of State certified that they had gotten Senate Bill 5's repeal on the ballot. And he was in town saying, we will spend everything we need to do to make this thing happen. And so the national unions are going to pour in so much money. So we are going to be against an onslaught here in Ohio. And if they win, anybody ever go down to the legislature and talk to your legislators? Ask about right to work. Have you ever asked about right to work? If you do, what do they say to you? Oh, 1958, we got killed at right to work, and oh, we can. Well, if the unions win in November, no one will talk about 1958 anymore. They're going to talk about 2011. And you can forget about big reforms going forward, even from conservatives, because their spines will get jelly down at the State House. They always do.
Does your research show school districts in the state of Ohio that pick up not only the 14% the boards are required to pay, but also the 10% that the employees pay?
It does not. And the reason why is we're a staff of three, and we just don't have the resources to collect all 613 collective bargaining agreements. We'd love to be able to do that, but the website shows the salary and all the estimated pension issues that allow you to see where you can look and see an elementary gym teacher is making $96,000 to teach essentially 1,350 hours a year, summers off, future vacation. And we need to have a policy discussion in Ohio. I mean, do we think we should be paying elementary gym teachers that much? And rather say, well, maybe we should pay them less, so that maybe we can frankly pay a physics high school teacher more, so that we attract better teachers at the higher levels, make sure our kids are getting what they need when they head off to college.
The reason I raise that question is I heard a politician who happened to be on our side make a statement the other day that there was a district that he knew of that paid 10% plus the 14. And attended meeting that guy, I heard several people really blasting because of that statement.
Yeah, well, it's true. I mean, my school district picks up the pension pickup of the administrator, so there's 16.
Well, the administrator, yes, that's been common knowledge every year.
Yeah. Yeah, so it's rare for the teachers. It's, you know, and that's something we need to keep in mind, right? I mean, we on the right spend a whole lot of time when we talk about government workers. Everyone always focuses on the firefighter, the police officer, the teacher, but we need to make sure that we're also hitting that management level, because they're dumb, fat, and happy too. And in some cases, more so than what we consider the rank and file, and that's why we need broad-based reform from top to bottom.
Has anybody addressed the character option in the political system as far as unions donate big money to politicians?
Especially in school election. Yeah.
Now, these are the same politicians that are voting on the union contract.
Right.
So now you have this politician, what's good for Ohio, what's good for my re-election? Where do they go? Human nature, they want to keep those cushy jobs.
Right.
Somebody should address this, and I don't know if there's some way they can not allow union money into their
campaign funds? I don't know how you police that or how.
Well, you can't. Supreme Court has found that that's that you can't restrict that.
And these same people know that the politicians are getting money from the unions for re-election and voting on our tax dollars, the union contracts.
Well, yeah, you know.
That's why it's so pushy.
Yeah, and I think that's where groups like the Buckeye Institute and Tea Party groups are supposed to really kind of put this the harsh light of sun onto these things. You know, my school district, one of the school board members, works for the FOP. Yeah, you can imagine how she votes, right? I mean, it's pretty obvious. And so, you know, we face that, and but because of that apathy, most people don't pay attention, and they just kind of go, oh, well, you know, we're a well-to-do community. But the rooster's coming home on these things, right? 613 school districts. By 2015, $7.6 billion deficit. Kid you not. Many of them are actually operating in deficits now, but because they have a rainy day fund that they had built up, that they're now spending down to cover that yearly deficit, by 2014, 2015, all those rainy day funds are gone. In my district, 2014, they're out of funds. They'll finish the year with an $18 million deficit. The next year, it jumps up to $56 million. So the only way you solve that is either compensation package reform. And by the way, in my district, by 2015, over 100% of revenue will go to compensation package reform. You can do the math on that, right? So either reform that or you raise taxes. And this is happening, by the way. One of the good things we have here right now in Ohio is a third of the counties will be sending out their county assessments to homeowners in the next week or two. And what those assessments are gonna show is we've all lost value, right? And so those of us who weren't irresponsible, who, you know, put the 20% down and have paid our bills and live by the rules, we're gonna have seen our equity gone. And the odds of that recovering anytime sooner are gonna be slim. And at the same time as we're losing value in our homes, the school districts and the cities and the townships and the state and the federal government are gonna say, but we need more of your money. That's crazy. And that's the one piece we need to make sure people understand is that we've got to fight back, because otherwise your taxes are going up. The state can.
So what are they going to do in their contract? The amount of money they're sending to the school district.
Which they've done.
And the amount of money they're sending to the cities for police and fire.
Which they've done.
And the very people that are fighting this to get this appeal are the very ones that are going to lose their jobs. The unions are out lying to them.
Yeah, I mean, look, SB 5, we did an analysis and we estimate it's going to save taxpayers about $1.4 billion a year if it's used by local governments in the state. The state actually is going to be okay. The reality is, because they are able to cut things like the local government fund, the problem's not going to happen at the state level. I mean, look, we were disappointed that we didn't see the governor cut compensation packages among state workers as one of the things that he did. Just didn't see that. So that left us a little bit frustrated. But all of that pressure is at the local level. And so that's where this is all gonna come to bear and come to fruition is local governments, because they've lost those fundings, they're gonna use that loss as the reason why they need to raise your taxes. But look, folks, those losses were there before the budget ever was passed. They're gonna use that as the excuse, but fundamentally they've been spending like drunken sailors, and I know some of you have been drunken sailors, they've spent like drunken sailors, and there's been no consequence because the revenues just came in Ohio, right? And our economy didn't produce as well as other economies. We had the 37th best job creating economy from 1990 to 2000. So during the boom years, our boom was the 37th worst. During the bust years of the aughts, the last decade, we were the second worst job economy in the country. Michigan was first, so we still beat Michigan at something, right? This is good. But the point is, our recovery is gonna be the same. We've not fundamentally changed the policies in Ohio. So any recovery that happens across the country, Ohio's will be a lagging recovery, which means they're not going to see this influx of cash. So they're going to have to either raise taxes or they're going to have to struggle and fight the battles at the bargaining table. And that's what Senate Bill 5 gives them ability to do. But don't kid yourselves. Senate Bill 5 is like taking the horse to water, right? You can't make those union-funded candidates actually use it. You have to create the pressure by defeating levies and creating more and more pressure, and they're going to come do the emotional blackmail. Oh, we're going to cut 10 teachers, we're going to get rid of music, art, and sports if you don't pass this levy. And you've got to have the courage to say, I'm going to call your bluff, right? And you've got to force the issue to say, so let me get this right. The Brotherhood of Unions, would rather let five teachers go than all of you take a 2% cut so nobody has to go. Is that what Brotherhood's about? Let's kick that new teacher, who may be a fantastic teacher, to the curb, so that way we can keep our piece of the pie. That is one of the things we've got to say again and again. You would rather lose three teachers than each of you take a 1% cut. That's really how you want to solve this problem.
You say they got over a million signatures against SB 5, right?
1.3 million.
Okay.
Almost a million were validated.
But here's the real point. There's enough information out of what Reed is involved in it, or a citizen like this, that's going to be on here. They're going to send mailings out, okay? You've looked throughout the state how many school levies have been passed. There's not that many school levies in the state that have been passed.
It's between 40% and 60% in any given year pass.
Right. But I truly think if there was enough information, I don't think SB 5 would be defeated, because there's so many people that's against the state unions anyway.
Yeah, here is the issue that we have. You are absolutely right. Where people have the information, they make the right choices. So, we've monitored this since we did the website, but our website salary tools have been used to fight levies, and they've won in 6 of the 7 levies where they fought. The one we lost was, we lost it by 242 votes, which was, that school district is a very wealthy school district. It was passing levies at about 65% of every time. So it passed by about 50.1%. Right. So they got super close to just by people, citizens, writing op-eds in the local newspaper saying, here's what their per pupil spending was in 2000, here's what it is today, here's what the median teacher pay was in 2000, here's what it is today. They're not making the fiscally smart choices on behalf of you. Defeat this levy and make them go back and figure out the right way to do this.
Up here in Northern Ohio, there's not that many school levies in that, I can tell you that right now.
Yeah, well, that's because you guys are hurting more than others, so you're feeling, you're the front of the curve in Ohio. But to get to the issue, let's put this in perspective. They submitted 1.3 million signatures. That's a whole lot of signatures, folks. So don't undersell that. In the 2009 November election, which was the off-year, right, non-presidential, there were things on the ballot. The total vote was about 3.2 million statewide for the entire thing. So they're almost halfway to getting 50% plus one of the 2009 turnout. They have, and by the way, they also have video, right, of the firefighter walking out of the burning building holding the child, the police officer in the dangerous area, the teacher in a bad setting doing the best she can. Very compelling emotional videos. We don't have that on our side, right? We don't. If we have a debate over the next 4 months on the specifics of Senate Bill 5, that does us no good, because, right, most voters aren't going to take the time to truly get educated. And as you talk about each provision, you're entering more and more complexity into the conversation. Voters deal with complexity by voting no. Right? That's just how they do it. They just, they're getting their kids to soccer practice, they're making ends meet, they're putting dinner on the table. They're not going to worry about these kinds of complex things. We have to have a broader debate in Ohio about, are you there for Ohio's future or for the special interest? Because this is really what it's about. It's either about the special interest called big labor, or it's about the future of Ohio. Because you cannot have both. If they win, the future of Ohio loses. It is that simple. If we cannot get the cost of government constrained in this state, your taxes will go up. It'll be a less friendly environment for businesses and people to live. Our best and brightest college students will graduate and do what they're doing today, which is heading south and west. So we will spend tens and thousands of dollars in our K-12 education system and our college education system to educate our kids, and the best and brightest will get jobs outside of Ohio and take their talent and their future of prosperity, entrepreneurship, ingenuity to other places, and they'll create jobs there, not here. So we've got to wrestle with this issue of the broader debate about an entrenched interest, big labor, against the future of Ohio and higher taxes.
I believe there's about 350,000
Yeah, there's about 770,000 government workers in Ohio. And don't just think about the union workers, because what the unions get, the rest of them get. So they're all the 770,000 have a vested interest in this. The average household in Ohio is about 2.1 people. So you're looking at about, let's call it 2.5 million, 3 million Ohioans who are going to have a financial vested interest in keeping what's theirs.
So basically, that's the group that's running the appeal then.
Yes.
So
what we need to do then really is to target people that's not in that group. We're reaching required, trying to get them to change.
We need to get the 8.5 million Ohioans who can obviously vote, that don't have a financial interest in the status quo, that have an interest in making Ohio that's there for them and their kids and grandkids, or prosperity. And I'm a fifth generation Ohioan. You know, I have two kids, as you know, right? There's one at home who's a 11-month-old little feisty guy. I don't want them. Right now, my daughter would tell you, if you ask them where they're going to go when they're older, the one's going to move to Colorado, the other one's going to move to California. I'm trying to talk her out of California, but she thinks the beaches are deep there.
Write off some of the counties in the state that we know how they're going to vote.
Yeah, Cuyahoga, Franklin. Yeah, sure, Mahoney, Trumbull. Yeah, we know which ones are Lucas. They're not going to go our way. We know that.
Will your institute be putting out information concerning which counties we really need to zero in on?
No, and here's why. We're a C3. We can't get out there and advocate for or against these things. We just get out there to educate, and getting into the voter roll kind of stuff goes beyond our ability to do.
But you leak that information to those of us who can.
All you have to do to figure that out, right, is you just go to the last go to the Secretary of State's website and go to the governor's race and look at the percentages of how each county voted for Kasich versus Strickland or Portman versus Fisher, and it's pretty clear which are the red and which are the blue, and where you should focus time and attention. Yeah.
Matt, I'm intrigued by your staff of three.